When I was planning this series, iOS 16 and Xcode 14 were still in beta, and I hadn't yet updated any one of my phones, my work phone or my test phone, to iOS 16. So I was testing on iOS 16 simulator, but an iOS 15 device. My completed project worked well, and for the final mode of gameplay, we will be requiring the multi-peer connectivity framework. But as I was planning this video, iOS 16 was released, and I finally updated my work phone to iOS 16, and I soon realized I had a problem. When you use the multi-peer connectivity framework, you'll need to broadcast who you are to others on the network using a display name. And prior to iOS 16, I could use the iPhone's user-defined device name for that display name so that it was obvious who was broadcasting their availability. In iOS 15 and earlier, this can be found using the UIDevice.current.name. And that is why, for my peer case, in which is the third mode, I don't require the input of a name for the owner of the phone for the player one. I simply use the current user's device name. Well, as I started to test on my iPhone with iOS 16 installed, that's where I found the problem. In iOS 16 and later, to access that information, you must meet certain criteria and be assigned an entitlement. And this is way more work than I want to go through. Now, instead of displaying the user's assigned device name, it uses a generic device name like iPhone, so everyone making themselves available would have used the same name. You may think that that's not a problem. Why don't I just ask for a name to use? Well, that's easier said than done, because in multi-peer connectivity, the way I've designed this app, it requires that I have a name before I get to the start screen, so that I can create an instance of my service class that I'll be creating using the name as one of my class parameters. I didn't need that before because I could have just used what was on the phone. So I could scrap the 5 videos I already created and go back and redesign the app from scratch. But that's a lot of work. So in this video, I'm going to go back and refactor some code that we already have working so that I'll be able to proceed with the multi-peer connectivity option in the next video. So please bear with me. This is the life of a developer. Things always come at you and you gotta be ready to make changes. So what I wanna do is to request a username on first launch and then store it in user defaults, then move on to the start screen. On the next launch, if it finds a name that has already been created, it'll bypass that first screen and go directly to the start screen. This means we'll no longer need to ask for your name on any of the game modes because we'll already have it. The other thing I'm going to have to do is be able to provide a way for the user to change their name. And this is another challenge because once I've created my service class, that display name that we use to broadcast our availability is read-only and can't be changed. This will make more sense once we start coding the class. So this is what I'm going to do. First, I'm going to create a new branch. And I'm going to call it refactored code. Now I'm going to open the app entry file and add a new app storage property with the key your name. And I'll assign it an empty string to a variable of the same name. Then within the window group block, I'll create an if clause that will check to see if your name is empty, meaning there's nothing stored there yet. Else, I'll display the start view if there is. Well, if your name is empty, we want to display a view that will allow us to create a new string for our app storage property. So let's create a new SwiftUI view, and I'm going to call it your name view. Inside there, I'll create the same app storage property for your name. Now, we want to be able to update this value, so you might think that we could use it as a bound value for a text field. The problem, though, is that as soon as I start typing into the text field, it'll no longer be empty, so it'll force a refresh of our app entry window group, and we'll be back to the start view with only one character entered. And I think we have to have names that are longer than one letter. So I'm going to create a second state property and call it username, that'll be a string, and that's what we'll be binding to our text field. So let's enclose this text field right now in a VStack. And I'm going to change the string for the text field to be, this is the name that will be associated with this device. Then I'll add a text field with the string your name and bind it to that username property. Then I'm going to set the style to rounded border. Next, I'll add a button with the label set. And the action will now be to change your name's app storage property to username. We'll set the button style to bordered prominent. And we'll make the button disabled if the username is empty. We want to force people to actually enter something. Just to fill the screen, I'm going to add an image using the launch screen asset. And then add a spacer to push it up to the top. Let's add some padding around the VStack, and we'll do as we did in the other views as well. I want a navigation title, so that means we're going to have to add a navigation stack. So as before, we'll first create the navigation title, and I'll use, as before, X's and O's, and then I'll use my view modifier in navigation stack to embed this into one. I can return now to my app entry point then, and when your name is empty, we'll just present this your name view. But first, let's just comment out this your name state property to see where we use it in our code. Those errors will give me that indication. Well, I'll no longer need to ask for it if playing against someone else because it will have been stored in the app storage and I'll already have it. So I can remove that here. Similarly, I'll no longer need to ask for it when I'm challenging a device, and that's when the mode is bought, because we already have it in app storage. So I'll just return an empty view here. I will need it in this setup function still though. So I'll need to add the app storage property back to our view so that we can get access to it. But since we know that this property cannot be empty, I can remove those checks from our disable check. Namely, no check is needed if the game type is a bot. And if the game type is single, we only have to check that we have the opponent's name. So let's uncomment this property then and change it to our app storage property. In the preview then, let's test. I see that if I choose to sharing, it now only asks me for the opponent name, and after entering, I can tap the start button. When I do this, however, there's no name for your name, and that makes sense here because the your name property for this view is an empty string, and the preview provider doesn't know about the app storage value. I can solve this problem then, along with an issue that I would have in our next video, by doing the following. Let's create an initializer for this struct and give it one parameter, your name, that's going to be a string. Now we'll need to go back to the app entry point and add that to the start view so that we can pass on our app storage property. This will create an error when we build, so I'll need to return to start view and in the preview provider put in some value for your name. I'll just use the text sample. This still doesn't fix things though. As you can see, we still can't see our name. So to solve the preview display issue, I can go back to our initializer and simply update the app storage your name property with the one that gets passed in, and our preview provider then will provide the sample. Now for the single game, when I enter my opponent's name and start the game, I see my sample name has been entered for me. If I choose to challenge the device, I don't have to enter a name at all because when I start that game, the sample name is entered for me and the preview display name is used for the opponent. Well, let's test on a simulator. When I launch the game for the first time, I'm asked to enter my name. Once I do that, the set button is active, and when I tap on it, I'm taken to the start screen. If I select the two sharing device option, I'm asked to enter my opponent's name, and when I start, I see both of our names entered. If I choose to challenge the device, no names are required for entry, and I can start the game. Both names are entered, and we can play the game just as before. This is almost perfect. But what if I want to change my name? How can I do that? Well, the problem is that I can change the name, but if I start a new peer game that I'll be creating starting in the next video, that name will not be used because we will have already used the old name to create our new service class, and once it's used, it can't be changed. So the solution I've come up with is to allow the user to change their name, but then force an exit of the app so that they'll be forced to restart. So in Start View, create a new state property called ChangeName and initialize it as false. Create another one for NewName and make it an empty string. Below the launch screen image, create a text view that lets people know what their current name is. Then below that, create a button with the label Change My Name. And for the action, it'll be to toggle that Change Name property. And I'll set the button style to bordered. Well, now we can use that Change Name property to initialize an alert that will ask the user if they want to change their name. And then I can use the new ability in IS16 to add a text field to that alert. So we'll start with an alert using the title key is presented actions message overload. For the title key, use change name. We'll bind is presented to our change name state property. For the actions, we can create a text field with the placeholder string new name and bind it to our new name property. Following that, we'll create two buttons. The first will be a button with the label OK, but I want to give it a role of destructive to make it stand out. Then the action will be to set the app storage your name property with the new name. And then I immediately use the exit -1 to force a quit. Now I'd love to be able to disable this button, but if I try that, it doesn't get displayed. However, it really doesn't matter because if they don't enter a name, when they launch the app again, it will go to that name entry screen anyway, because it'll be empty. The other thing is that this ability to add a text field to an alert is an iOS 16 feature only. And we have a minimum deployment target of iOS 15. Well, the good news is that this doesn't cause an error or a crash. It just leaves the text field out of the alert. So in our case, then when a user taps on the OK button, it'll just set the app storage value back to an empty string. And on the next launch, they'll be forced to enter their new name. We do want to give people the ability to cancel, however, so we'll add a cancel button with a role of cancel, but no actions required. And then finally, for the message, I'm going to display a text with the string tapping the OK button will quit the application so you can relaunch to use your changed name. You can see what this looks like in the preview, but let's put it to a test in the simulator. When I launch the app, I see that my name, Stuart, is pulled from app storage. If I tap on the change my name, I could enter a new name like Colin. And then when I tap on OK, the app quits. When I launch it again, I see that it's been stored in app storage, so I'm good. Let's do this once more. This time, however, I'm not going to enter anything into that name field. When I press on OK, the app exits as before. This time, however, when I open the app, it recognizes that nothing's been entered, and I'm asked to enter a name, because the one stored in app storage is an empty string. Perfect. So before we move on to the next video, though, let's commit our changes to our refactored branch.